through it, yeah? All right, go ahead. Social media, feeling disconnected, right? I say, you know, if it's all about me, right? Our world's kind of small. If it's all about me, you know, our world's small, right? But if we are giving and kind and there for other people and we open up ourselves to give, we open up our arms to receive. And that includes love as well and kindness and good relationships. But if it's just all about me, right? So people ask me, like, what do you do for work? And I said, I take care of victim-fulfilled parenting and an all-about-me society, right? And it's just like, people don't know how to cope. So social media, other things? Diagnosed mental illnesses? Yeah? Okay. Yeah? Yeah? Absolutely. All right. And then, go ahead.
Economy and politics
can play a role, right? So the suicide rates in Nevada are actually going down. Like, when you're looking at the states, where it's like Montana and Wyoming, they're going up. Montana and Wyoming is like the crystal meth epidemic, whereas Nevada's having a huge financial boom right now. So yeah, absolutely. Those things play a role. But then more normalization, right? So it's like, let's just say like your hero commits suicide, right? And that was the person you really wanted to be, gravitated to be, and they committed suicide, and like your dream life was their life. Like, wow, well, my life really sucks, and my hero committed suicide, so why should I even try? Does that make sense? You're seeing it on the news. So every time there's a lot of suicides, the suicide hotline goes up a lot as well. Okay, so again, this is just a different book, 2015. Suicides in the United States. So once every 12 minutes, someone dies by suicide. And it's 25 or 26 based on the statistics. For every suicide, there's that many attempts. Okay? And so, have you guys heard about borderline personality disorder yet? Right? Did you guys have it in this class? Okay. So borderline personality disorder, right? Self-interest behavior without suicidal ideations is quite common, right? Why do we have to take some of that stuff very seriously? Like, it's sometimes treated as a suicide. Right? So it's like, oh, I just like to cut my wrist because it's fun and it makes me feel good and I get a release. So, but it's like, what happens when you just cut the wrist too deep, right? Maybe it wasn't even a suicide, but it definitely appears to be. So that's why we have to take that kind of stuff very seriously. And people will, you know, the craziest suicide attempt I ever had, sometimes I tried to suffocate myself with a bunch of dog poop, you know? And it's like, to, you know, somebody, like, you know, I have a paper cut, like I was going to kill myself, and you have to just kind of take it seriously, whatever people have to report. So just like that gentleman said back there, politics, climate change, whatnot. So if you sit there and you look at the red states, I'm sorry, it's Idaho, not Montana, that's going up. Red states, look at Nevada, it's going down 1%, and the red is really down. And that's the areas with like the big crystal meth epidemic and the ramifications of that, how it's impacting your family, perhaps you had an uncle or whatnot, or your dad committed suicide, now you're the kids, you know, why is this all going on? All right. Different methods, right, between the sexes, and also too, you know, does everyone who commits suicide have a mental illness? Huh? No? Okay. So I'm in the military, right? And there's this really good, you know, obviously, you know, we train. There's this really good video out, and this guy's over in Afghanistan, right? Everything's going really good for him. He's really happy. He has this roommate who's intuitive, right? Being intuitive is one of the big things to help decrease intuition because it's not about you. You're kind of empathic, and you're kind of about other people as well. But he has this roommate, right? And he's like, oh, I can't wait to go home and see my wife, and we're gonna do this. And he's been talking about that for, you know, 8 months, right? And they're going home the next month. And he gets divorce papers, right? And that was like the happiest, most joyful thing in his life, right? And so his roommate being, you know, he just goes down, prompts really, really hard. Not a mental illness, again, not a mental illness. But his roommate is really intuitive, right? He's not an all-about-me type of person. And so he waits till he leaves the room and pulls a firing pin out of his weapon, right? Just so he can't shoot himself. So he goes back in, his roommate leaves, has a firing pin in his pocket, and he goes back in that night, and the guy's like on the bed crying and shaking, and he's like, I just tried to kill myself, but this gun never went off. He's like, I know. He's like, I just had this bad, intuitive, trust your gut feeling, and I pulled the firing pin. So again, you do not have to have a mental illness to try to kill yourself. Many people who try try to kill themselves, they don't have a mental.
All right. And that's the whole thing too. People say, oh, well, you know, suicides contribute to antidepressant use. No, more people who are depressed commit suicide than people who aren't. And, you know, the tiny percentage of individuals, although we have to be thoughtful of it, that commit suicide, you know, that have that initial effects of energy. So, but what's the most common month that people commit suicide? They get to another unhealthy abusive relationship, and perhaps they're the abuser, and then they hate and resent themselves for being an abuser. Yeah, absolutely. And then too, it's just like, I was so unloved as a kid, I could never be lovable. So even though like, I'm over this childhood abuse, maybe I'm smart, maybe I have a degree, maybe I have a home, but how could I ever be lovable? I wasn't loved then. How could I ever be lovable, right? And we are human, wired to be connected. connected and love and care and be attached to people, right? So many times I really like, just because the people whose jobs it was to love you did not love you, does not mean you're not lovable, right? I'm very, like, for me, I have to know myself in mental health, right? I'm very solution focused, right? And I'm gonna give it to people very straight. And I tell people, if you don't want that, that's fine. I can refer you to someone else. Or get your case manager to get you help from someone else. But I'm not gonna, sit there and go, my dad never loved me, and he was such a bastard, and yada, yada, yada. Like, okay, I get it. But that doesn't mean that you're not lovable. That doesn't mean that you can't find people who love you and care about you and support groups and people who will be there for you and people who enrich your life. You've suffered enough. Let's have some love in your life, because that's what you deserve. That's what we're all worthy of, love and belonging. Okay? All right. So other risk factors. Previous suicides, we kind of talked about that. Risk factors, mental health disorders, feelings of hopelessness, right? Impulsive behavior, aggressive tendencies, right? What impulsive? Use of the green shirt, the green hat. Yeah, why the impulsive behaviors? The suicide risk factor. Admit this person to the hospital, because getting admitted to a psych ward can sometimes be very undignified, right? So I sit there and say, you know, sometimes it's like, get them to the hospital, you know, maybe they're really sad, maybe somebody in their family died, then they get strip searched, make sure they don't have any drugs or weapons or anything on them. Then they get admitted, but that's after waiting for 16 hours in the emergency room. Then another 8 hours to be seen by mental health, so it's 24 hours late, you know, and that in itself can just be exhausting. So it's like, can I do everything I can in outpatient so I don't have to admit this person? But sometimes I have incredible anxiety. Am I making the right decisions? What if I make the wrong decision? If they make, you know, they are suicidal. So I have to use that discernment and that good judgment. But one of the things that really helps me, I say, well, what is your faith background? They're like, oh, I'm a devout Catholic. I'm like, so would you ever commit suicide? Well, I would like to, but I'll go to hell, so I won't, because I'm afraid of hell. Like, oh, good. You know, like, that's one of the things that helps. Like, great, why are you afraid of hell? You know, that helps me do my job better. All right. But after years and years of taking care of thousands and thousands of people who have tried to commit suicide, and I would sit there at their bedside and be like, well, why did you try to kill yourself, right? And a lot of times, like my first book, Why You Try to Kill Yourself, like I'm sitting there with somebody, like, well, I just don't know. You know, he's like, you just told me this very in-depth life story, and you have no insight into why you would try to kill yourself. And then I'll summarize and say, well, you know, this is why I think you try to kill yourself. Your life's a lie. You don't have real relationships. You don't have real friendships. Everyone in your life is users. You're getting to the point of depletion. You know, it's per situation. And so, you know, that was a statement, but many times I say, well, why'd you try to kill yourself? I don't have anyone who loves me, you know? I'll never get another girlfriend. I cheated on my wife, my life's over. She was the love of my life. You know, sometimes I'm like, well, okay, well, you know, you're lucky sometimes, you know? You messed up really bad when you're 25, you know, but you have a chance to start over. You know, you have a chance to get it right. You know, that's not the end of the world. And I'm very empathetic, and I spend a lot of time. But, you know, I have anyone to listen to me. So I'm going to go over some of the things that I really, in my heart and soul, believe helps. So listening. Sometimes all a person needs is an empathetic ear. All he or she needs is to talk it out. Just offering a listening ear and understanding heart for his or her suffering can be a big comfort. Right? And then I said, the power of listening. Closing your mouth and just listening is truly one of the most powerful things we do in mental health. Why is that? Okay, all right, get them. Right? Good.
I feel less alone.
You feel less alone? Yep. All right. Fly back and fly out to Maine the next.
and on a Sunday night and would arrive. I had to go home, take care of my dogs, repack. I had like 8 hours between flights, and it was in winter time and everything else, and I had maybe 8 hours.
And so I get off my phone, I get off the plane, and I see that I have all these text messages, right? And it was from a lady in my neighborhood, right? And I knew she has money, a beautiful home. And she didn't say she was suicidal at all, but I saw the number of times that she texted me, right? And so I knew in my heart and soul that something was wrong. You know, like, oh, how's it going? Just thinking of you. What's going on? And like the frequency of the text messages was out of character. So I'm like, oh my God, I have 8 hours. You know, I'm like, and I'm gonna get enough sleep, and I gotta be in Maine tomorrow, and I'm teaching for a week, and I'm exhausted, and I gotta put my dogs out, and I need to do self-care. But I went over to her house, and I said, all right, how's it going? We had dinner. She's an international host as well. And I just kind of sat there, and I let her talk and talk it out. And then at the end, I said, you know, we went and walked our dogs. I said, were you thinking about suicide? She's like, yeah, I kind of was, but I'm not now. And I was like, but I had paid attention to the number of texts, right? And just, I went there, and I just gave her my physical presence. So compassion, right? We can live in a very cold, uncompassionate world, right? And as nurses, right, all of you guys, you're giving so much to yourself that you don't stop to realize that your cup is not being filled in return, right? When I think when I really got sick, you know, I really saw who people's true colors were. You know, because I was always so high energy and give, and I was like, oh, I'm sick. Where's the compassion? Where's the empathy, you know? And it's just, you know, some girl told me her sister had died in a really bad car accident. And somebody, you know, was there, you know, it's all about me kind of person. And she's saying, so anyway, how's so-and-so doing? And she's like, she died 5 years ago in a car accident. She's like, are you sure? I thought it was your other sister. I'm like, oh, cool. You know what I mean? It's like so uncompassionate. But that is not so atypical in our culture. All right, empathy, right? What's the difference between empathy and sympathy? Right? So what if I say, my dog died last week, and it hits you in the heart? Sympathy, right? Carry. Sometimes people just like, you know, people just need to like, you know, so like there's different schools of thought in nursing. Like someone's, oh, we care, we show emotions. I'm like, well, you don't ever even touch somebody on the shoulder, you know, because that's considered assault. Like, no, I don't buy into that. I think it's BS, and I think that's wrong. You know, like, we are designed to be in connection, right? Babies around the world have died from not being touched and loved. So we are designed to be connected. You know, granted there are some weird perverts in this world and they should never touch people, but for the most part we need to be connected to people and feel empathetic. So when you feel compassion and empathy for somebody, it is saying your pain matters to me. You know, yeah, it would be really hard if my child died as well. You know, like somebody, you know, and I know myself well enough to know I'm a very high energy person, you know, most of the time. And so for me, you know, I'm having to take care of a few people after their children have died, you know. I'm very good in the prison setting, you know, like, this is what it's going to be. This is the rules in this world. I'm sick too. But I have to stop. I have to be thoughtful in my energy. And I have to bring all the way down and just be present. And I'm sitting there, and it's so unintuitive to me because I have to slow myself down and just be like, I'm just going to sit by you and cry for 45 minutes and be present and listen to them. You know, because like, what you, like my baby died off. What do? Like, you know, it's so sad. You can't sit there, well, just get on with your life. You can't say anything. You just be present. And they're like, but I'm still a nurse. So are you eating and are you drinking? Are you getting outside? Are you taking care of your vitamins? How's your sleep? You know? But you have to really know that. So you have to be empathetic. Understanding people. Knowing where they come from. I find the best way to understand others is to stop when I want to say something and continue to listen to what they have to say. So many times they articulate exactly what I'm thinking. And that confirms that I understood where they were coming from. However, I am also frequently surprised. You know, like so many times people are in a really, really unhealthy relationship. In my work, I say, I'm pro-divorce, you know, because I'm not pro-unhealthy relationship. Like, if you want to save a bad marriage, you should talk to the couple.
And it's like I'm sitting there so frustrated because they won't leave this super, super unhealthy relationship because, you know, they just can't be alone because health is not treatment. Yes.
How would you describe aspects of a
unhealthy relationship? Stealing from you, lying to you, cheating on you, opening up credit cards in your name and like maxing them out, putting your credit report, making a commitment to have a family, and then, you know, like you sit there and think, oh, we're trying to have a kid, but I have an IUD and I didn't even tell you, and I belittling you, berating you, talking to your friends, talking down to you, yelling at you, screaming at you, lying. All right. Is that good enough? So, oops, I have a lot more, but I gotta finish this conversation. Yeah, lots more. So, yeah, understanding. But, you know, sometimes it's just like, they know. They're like, I'm in this unhealthy relationship, and I need to know. Okay, but you need to know on a deeper level. All right, boundaries, right? So many times, like, as nurturing, this is so important. When we fail to set boundaries and hold people accountable, we feel used and mistreated. This is why we sometimes attack who they are, which is far more hurtful than address their behavioral choice, right? So in nursing too, sometimes we just give. That example of me going to that lady's house, she's, you know, in her mid-70s, was not a good boundary for me, but I felt, you know, risk-benefit. But the other thing is, when you set boundaries for people, right, when you have, like, somebody who, like, you know, gets stressed out and wants to call you at 2 o'clock in the morning, A, you're affecting your health, but if you said that, say, you will not call me after 9 p.m., because I'm going to go to sleep and I value my health. Why is that a better choice than answering the phone at 2 in the morning when they want to have a spastic conversation? Why is setting the boundaries a good thing? Okay. Stability. Like, this is stable. You know, it's not normal to wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and start calling people. Like, I'm going to show you this is what stable is. You're not going to take advantage of me. You need to self-soothe. Yes?
And you also have to think about yourself.
Yeah, you have to think about yourself. You know, so many times, like, veterinarian suicide is very high. I've heard it's 2 times higher in male veterinarians and 3.5 higher in females. It's like, you know, you go into this profession, you're like, I love animals, and I save all these animals. And then they're putting animals down and seeing animal abuse over and over and over, and just the lack of boundaries. If you don't stop and care for yourself, you're much more likely to be exhausted, worn out, compassion fatigue, believing someone, right? So, has anyone ever lied about a health condition to get a medication? Ever? Has that ever happened? Has anyone ever reported a false sexual assault because, you know, different reasons, right? Maybe they're cheating or something like that. It happens, right? So I used to volunteer with Sarah, right? Sarah is a sexual assault resource agency. And there was nothing that we could get. All we could do was just be available. That was my only job. My dog was the mascot. I would sit there. People would come up to me and tell me their sexual assault story. I did nothing for them other than listen and be present for them. It's like they wanted help. There's a victim's advocate. I'm with Sarah. But the philosophy was, we believe them, right? And that doesn't mean that we're naive, that doesn't mean we don't call people out, but you have to believe people in a certain aspect. So if somebody needs drugs, right? And they're like, you see them like sprinting across the parking lot, and they're all happy, then they get to your office, and they're like, oh my God, that hurts so bad, right? Why do you act like you believe them? Or why would that be beneficial? Maybe. Like, give them the honesty, but it's like, maybe I don't believe it in meds, but I believe that there's something really going on. I believe that maybe you're in a lot of emotional distress and you really don't need that hydrocodone, but you want it to numb your emotions. So what's going on with that? So I believe that something's wrong. You know, if you call somebody a liar, you just ended that conversation. You know, then they go on to reality feedback. So reality feedback, right? Authenticity is everything. You have to wake up every day and look in the mirror, and you want to be proud of the person who's looking back at you. And you can only do that if you're being honest with yourself and being a person of higher character. You have the opportunity every single day to write the story of your life. The only way in life for us to grow, develop ourselves is if we persevere, we role model, and we have wise counsel. Seeking wise counsel can definitely be tricky, you know? So it's like, what is this person's real agenda for you? So we have, like, what does this person really want from me? You know, somebody comes to my phone tree, I'm like, right? Like, part of how I stay mentally healthy and mentally sane is I'm not super serious, you know? I have to, I take life seriously, but I don't always take myself seriously. But reality feedback is like, okay, you know, like, somebody's like, oh, you know, it's the end of the world, my relationship just ended, she dumped me, she was the most amazing woman ever, right? Predominantly, I take care of men. And one of the things I do, right? And I'm like, well, what's your dream girl like? Right? Every single thing you've ever wanted. And they're like, oh, I don't want to do that. I'm like, well, I want to come in on a Saturday evening to see you, but I'm here anyway, so we're going to make it happen. So I'm like, well, I want her to be nice. I want her to be kind. I want her to be, you know, loyal. And I'm like, okay, and what is she? Well, she's nice. Like, really? You're here all upset because she cheated you on you with your friend and you guys were in a monogamous committed relationship. That doesn't seem very nice now, does it? You know, that's reality feedback and like making people see, like it's really putting a mirror to their face. That's reality, you know? And it's like, you know, but you sit there and you get some time and you keep processing this, like make people understand maybe they do deserve better. Maybe life will go on. Maybe there are other options. So I always put that in there. So September tips, suicide prevention date. And this lovely young lady over here in the blue shirt, she said validation, right? Validate. Validate is my absolute favorite word. Why is that? Very, very much. But how I treat somebody is a reflection of me as a nurse, not a reflection of them. How can I treat somebody is about me, not about them, right? So this is a very bad person. I just like, I find despicable. I would go out of my way to avoid them. But I am their nurse caring for them. How do I validate them? She's looking at me. She knows. She's like, oh, look, she's happy to let you take me.
Sorry. I think the way you would validate them is maybe ask them why they felt like that was what they did or like why they did it, and then maybe like go back into what happened to them before, like maybe what caused them to do that.
Okay. Well, so many times we have to think we have to validate the behavior. Sometimes we don't. Sometimes it's like, okay, what you're feeling. Maybe, like, you know, even like someone who has schizophrenia, it's like you have all these feelings, but they don't exist, right? So, like, a lot of people have schizophrenia, they're incredibly lonely. They're desperately lonely because, oh, they're crazy. I don't want to talk to that person. So, the loneliness is profoundly difficult for them to deal with, and it makes the situation worse. So, when you don't have to necessarily validate them on the behavior or the action, sometimes you can validate them on their health. Like, okay, you did these horrible things. But you're here in the prison, and you're doing this work, and that's a good thing. You're working on your health. That's a good thing. This guilt that you feel, that's actually a really good thing, because you're not a complete sociopath. Like, it's good to feel guilt, you know? And it's just kind of like, you know, I grew up thinking, like, murdering was normal, and, like, she's telling me that guilt is normal? Like, you know, so you don't have to validate the behavior. You can validate something about them or their character, you know? So I want to make sure, what's your name? Yeah, when you do validate people's emotions, you sometimes say that's like, I really don't think that person hates you that bad. I think you're really tired and exhausted, and maybe you're thinking about it a little wrong. Does that make sense? So you're listening to them, you're hearing them, but sometimes you're giving them some autopsychotic. All right, so I'm going to go over just a couple more, and then I'm just going to open up to questions. So sympathy, be sincere, meet individuals where they're at, right? Provide ego strength. What does providing ego strength mean?
you're in a really unhealthy, abusive relationship, and I know that you can get through this. And maybe you don't feel like you have your strength, but I am going to literally, like, give you some of my strength so that you can make this happen. Like, you know, I am going to, here's the resources. This is a domestic abuse hotline. You can call. They leave feeling very energized. Like, certain people will drain you, certain people will inspire you. It's kind of inspiring them to be their best. That's providing ego strength. Emotional stability. Sometimes it's just role modeling. Like, I do have love for it. It's not that shit crazy. And then perspective, you know? Let's think about this different. Support and support groups. You know, support is so important. You know, certain times it's so important to do an inventory of your life. You know, go away for a weekend, go on a cruise. Say, who are these people who are really in my life? Does this person add value and enrich my life or not? And if you don't add value and enrich my life, I don't really have time for you because I'm a very giving person and I need to give to people and I need to give to my patients and I need to give to volunteer work and I need to give to my rescue animals. And you're just draining me with your toxicity. So I need to unfriend you in the life. You know, we need to break up.
So it's like, you got to think about that. And you're like, are the people around me, are they supporting me? Are they helping me be the best? I mean, sometimes like the fun people in the world are the impulsive people. Like, hey, look at my credit card. They're like $28,000 in a day. And it's like, oh my gosh, Sean. Be authentic. Think out of the box. This is so important. Thinking out of the box is so important in nursing. And so many times it's like, we get so nervous about everything that's going on in nursing. Like, how many of you guys are like really worried about missing IDs right now? Like, being submitting certain IDs. Like, that's kind of like what you're kind of nervous about. You know, they're like, oh, I got that. You know, I'll miss it. I'll give it the next try. It sucks, but hopefully not. Hopefully get really good at it. But, you know, even like, you know, it's so skilled. But sometimes you just have to stop and step back and be like, wait a second, this is a person that I'm caring for. What do they really need from me? You know? And so you can sit there and say, okay, well, psychology, there's this 12-step workbook, and we're going to do this session, and this session, and this session. And sometimes people need that guide, but sometimes you just have to sit back and be like, well, what is it that you really need, you know? And so many times I get people involved in church groups, support groups, you know, other social activities. You know, I sit there and say, okay, you can sit there and say, I'm so depressed, but what I'm really finding is you're deeply lonely, and you're surrounded by a bunch of users, right? That's my reality feedback. And maybe you need to be around some good people in your life. And here's a good, healthy group. You know, like that is, you know, thinking about what they need. You know, creating a vision for someone. Helping people understand what they can become. Believe it or not. Our words that we say are so powerful. Very, very powerful. You know, don't talk down about yourself. About yourself, you should be giving yourself praise and compliments. I think that's what I can make sense. I'm very, very, very good looking. All of those things, you know. Right? All right, motivate people, inspire them, give them hope, faith, and then love. And I say that, like, you know, we live in this such a standoffish, don't, you know, like I had one of the nurses I worked for, her, I call her demonic dementor, like, you know, she was just such a cold-hearted person, like, oh, we wouldn't touch someone's shoulders. You know, like, if someone's kid just died, or, you know, someone's mom just committed suicide, I'm going to touch their shoulders. I'm going to show that I care. I'm going to show that I'm a compassionate person, because people die without love. And they die without being cared for, right? And not just through suicide, I'm talking about through infant death and whatnot. All right, that's it. Any nursing questions, NCLEX questions, any questions about suicide prevention? Floor is open. Yes, I thought you do it first, Becca. So you do. Well, first of all, you know, I'm very authentic, but I set very big boundaries. You know, like this past weekend, I was at a hotel, just to come up, relax, and stuff like that. I know that even though, like, I can get up here and I can talk, I'm actually quite introverted, and I have to have a lot of alone time to recharge, and I have to set those boundaries, and Becca, that's you, and that's your craziness. You know, you do feel sad, you do feel empathetic, but you do, you know, at the end of the day, I give my absolute best care to that person and know that we are ultimately people of free will and then we can make their decisions. A lot of self-care, a lot of really good support, and a lot of good support groups, and having really good, kind, enriching, loving people. And then doing things in my life, I try to live a personal, very healthy life, healthy relationships, right? Animal rescue. And I come home and I'm like suffocated by a dog, you know, all over me. All right, you, sir. But when you are taking care of someone's mental health and you are saying, okay, this is healthy behavior, this is unhealthy behavior, to go home and yell and scream at your wife or your kids and treat them like this, or to be sad, and I sit there and say, you know, I tell men this all the time, because my patients are all men, I say, if you are role modeling, if you come in here and say, oh, I don't care about my happiness, it's just about my kids' happiness and my wife's happiness, you know what you're doing? You're teaching your kids that when you grow up to be an adult, that you shouldn't be happy, that you should be miserable, that you should be worked to death and tired. Is that fair to your kids? Because as your kid owns, they're going to think, wow, it really sucks to grow up to be an adult. So helping my patient get healthy is one of the best things, but then I do a lot of education, and I give a lot of education to the family on resources. So I'm huge into a solution focus and education focus. All right. And then, you know, encouraging them to volunteer and get to community events, go do this walk together. You know, really getting them involved in life. Like by suicide?
No, just died.
Well, what's the situation? Like, is it like in the emergency room and it's a gunshot wound, or is it like an expected death because the person's like 90 with cancer, or is it like a child death?
I was just thinking in general, like just death, but I guess you could say someone in the ER that just passed away and you're helping with their care and they passed away.
Yeah. Because, you know, because sometimes it's just kind of like, it's, you know, it's like the amount of shock is so different between expected and unexpected. Like, you know, sometimes people's family members have been like, had dementia for years and they're suffering so bad. And sometimes the family's like, wow, they're finally at peace. It's finally a relaxation for them. You know, they feel good. And whereas other people's like, my kid just got ran over and like, they can't even move. They're numb. You have to just really gear it towards the situation and just know everyone reacts differently to death. But again, all of those words, time, being present, listening, you know, sometimes you just don't say anything. You just go there and sit and stand. And it's like, you know, that person actually cared. They came and just stood here. They didn't say anything. You know, or, you know, time again, my friend would be like, because we'll call me. Oh, this friend's family member or whatever just called. What do I say? How do I handle it? I'm very sorry. Is there anything I can do to help you? And then give them their space. And then a few days later, call.
Say more for yourself.
Right. Okay, so for yourself, like you're freaked out because you just saw somebody die. I mean, I think you have to go and do self-care. You have to get sleep. You have to do an inventory in your life. You have to, you know, really be like, okay, I'm really sad to see that young person die. I feel really bad for our family. You know, am I living my life the best I can? Am I doing the best thing for myself that I can enrich and add value to other people's lives? You know, let yourself feel the emotions. Don't deny them. You know, what you resist persists. Yeah.
So I had a really close friend who was in like a bad relationship, and every time, so it would like really affect her grief and mental health. And every time we would like try to talk about it, I did not I didn't really like support the relationship.
Uh-huh.
And because I didn't support the relationship, she felt like I wasn't supporting her.
Uh-huh.
Like, how do you approach a situation where like you really want to support and help a person, but like they're in a bad relationship where they're not making like they don't see the full picture of like how it's made to be affecting the couple?
Yeah. Well, sometimes I just keep mimes, like, this is what it's like to have a better life, or, you know, you're beautiful, you deserve better, this is what a healthy relationship should look like, you know, sometimes we give them a big hug, tell them how much I care about them, let's do a spa day. Relationships are about feeling good, relationships are about give and take, you know, at the end of the day, after spending time with someone, they should be your bright spot in your day, you should enjoy them, and you just keep reinforcing what healthy relationships is. That's one of the ways. You deserve better, you deserve love. Oh, yeah, I have friends who are brilliant. I'm never going to get an unhealthy relationship. It drives me nuts. And they know better. And they have the resources to move on. And their life will be 1,000 times better. And it's just kind of like, you know, it's like I can go out once every 3 months on keto for dinner. And it's like during that time, you're just kind and loving and supportive. But at the same time, too, it's like you have to think about how much energy you're going to invest because that's their decision. Okay, yeah.
What are some differences you see with working between like adolescents?
So I intentionally don't work with adolescents. I have, when I was at San Diego State, a very wonderful school, and one of the things I really loved about San Diego State, they taught me so much, and I don't know if they're still doing it. They used to make us go out and find all kinds of like a resource scavenger hunt. They made us go to Al-Anon, all kinds of stuff like that, just to see what's out there. And it's benefited me, probably more so than anything, because that's what I do for my patients. I know about all this personally. San Diego State made me go if I wanted to do the great. But I intentionally do not work with adolescents because I take care of pediatrics, and they have severe asthma, and their parents are smoking right next to them. It's like the amount of rage that I feel for that vulnerable victim is not healthy, and I know that. Like, it's easier for me to take care of like a serial killer. Like, okay, you did this in your response, but I can't do that for a child. You know what I mean? Like, this person is putting pain on you, and you have to live with them. It's not healthy for me. But being the fact I think they're very young adults and older adults, you know, it's just, and you know, you look at the maturity, you look at what's going on, you look at mental maturity, intellectual maturity, you know, how much is this person's family enabling them and not helping them grow, you know? Do you have a specific question? Like, do you guys answer a specific question?
Yeah. Do you feel like it's easier to get through, you know, a younger adult? Like, you feel like they're kind of more of a blank slate, and like older adults are kind of more stubborn?
More, you know, if you can literally see the best in them.
revolves around you, but you are in relationships and people that want to be around you, and whatever, you know, like, I can check my back. Alright, does that make sense? It's like, I can't get through to them, like, the narcissism and the selfishness, it can definitely be more, the other kind of people are under 25, have more traits of narcissism than people above 25, because, you know, life hasn't humbled them enough. But at the same time, it's like, you know, if you're a good child, and you can have a loving influence on them, you know, that's a completely different situation. Alright, you don't have to do this video. Any other final questions? Alright. Okay, make sure that you guys have no associate for salary, don't take anything low, because that hurts all of us. Take the big pay, so, because it's not, you know, I was talking to a recruiter the other day, it's like, they offered me a salary that, when they're getting new grad, MPs. And I said, well, just so you know, that these are the other salaries that we don't. He said, well, you're just money grubbing. And I said, no, actually, I value myself, I really value myself. I said, I went to good universities, and I've done a job for a long time, and I wrote a couple books, and I started programs. So it's not a matter of being money grubbing, it's a matter of, I went to San Diego State, and I passed the NCLEX, and there's some turnout classes there, and it was a good school. So if you want to pay somebody low, maybe you go somebody who, you know, is fairly educated, who didn't have to put as much work, because I value myself. So that's very important. It's not that about being money grubbing.
I just thought of one more question.
Okay.
Have you heard of 13 Reasons Why?
Yeah.
So what is your perspective on the glamorizing suicide versus bringing awareness to suicide from that show?
Yeah, it's bold, and I think it's really a perspective. Like last month in this class, one girl raised her hand and she said, there was a girl in my class that committed suicide, and we wanted, you know, a lot of us wanted to have a memorial for her. And the principal said, no, there's certain people that's going to just kind of glamorize and normalize it, whereas other people, it's just an awareness. I don't know. You know, so it's so individual, so the individual person, you know. I don't think there's anything ever wrong with saying, have healthy relationships, and have love, and have all of these 30 things that I put in this slide, so you don't feel the need to commit suicide. There's nothing wrong with that. It's like, ooh, this person committed suicide because, you know, I'm just so in love and I romanticized it. It could go either way, you know? So, it's worth the healthiness. All right, any other final questions? So all the stuff that you're really worried about with nursing, it's going to be completely different when you get out there. And like, 98% of you are going to pass the NCLEX the first time, so don't worry.